I'm delighted to be here today. I'm especially delighted to be speaking after Sarah Chayes, whose father, Abe Chayes, was my law professor at Harvard, my favorite professor. And so there is certainly a sense in which this is an intergenerational kind of commitment to social justice and cleaning up the bad guys, because Abe was a terrific fighter in addition to his work in the legal area. He was also very involved in lots of good causes. Well, there is a growing list of reasons to be insecure about the world economy. We have a long list of problems that I believe can only be solved through collaboration and by spending a whole lot of money. Climate change, cybersecurity, the need to protect immigrants and refugees, as we've talked about in the last day or so, and a whole host of many other issues, investments in education and health and infrastructure, can only be funded and supported by countries that are working together. And yet, in the last three decades, we have seen a trend toward increasing tax and regulation competition among countries. We've seen a kind of race to the bottom, and we've seen the growth of what I call the global haven industry, which really cuts across the more than 90 tax havens that are offshore really provides services to those of the elites, corporations, and the top 1% who want to take their money and put it offshore and become citizens of nowhere for tax purposes. So this is a disturbing trend that we absolutely have to take personally if we're going to attack these problems. We've tried all the other ways of financing public expenditure. We've tried debt, we've tried inflation. We've tried privatization, and frankly, they're strictly inferior. We can't get out of the problem of having to raise an essential, 20 to 30% of GDP every year worldwide to spend on public goods. And if we don't have the richest people on the planet participating in that obligation, the problem is going to devolve to the middle class and the poor, and it's going to exacerbate the kind of inequality we've already been seeing. I have a website that we're releasing today called globalhavenindustry.com, and it has a lot of detail about all of this. Tax Justice Network, the organization that I work with, is a bunch of volunteers. In the last decade, we basically helped to put the issue of tax justice and the behavior of financial secrecy havens on the agenda to the point where the G20, the OECD, and the EU is debating many of the proposals that we've come up with. And one of the strategies we took here was to follow the recommendation of Lord Kelvin, who said that if your knowledge cannot be enumerated, cannot be made metric, cannot be precise, it is a meager and unsatisfactory kind. So we have gone where organizations like the World Bank, the IMF, should have gone in terms of quantifying the size and growth of the haven industry and understanding its structure. I asked the deputy director of the IMF, you have 3,000 economists. Why is Tax Justice Network with four economists, left to do the spade work on the haven industry? He said, well, you have to understand that 80 of our members are tax havens. It was as simple as that. I just want you to understand that we can actually quantify the size and growth of much of this misbehavior, including kleptocracy. The overall headline numbers, about $24 to $34 trillion of financial wealth, personal financial wealth, is located or invested through tax havens as of 2014. About $12 trillion of that came from developing countries, the top 30 of which are dominated by what I would call kleptocracies, China, Russia, Saudi Arabia, Nigeria. These non-democratic countries basically account for more than half of the $12 trillion from the developing world. And that's where the largest growth in flight capital has occurred in the last 5 years. Russia, China, more than $1 trillion pouring out of China, some of it through Australian-owned casinos, I understand. A second key fact about this is that the offshore wealth is highly concentrated. It's owned by, we're talking about the top 10 million people on the planet, about 0.014% of the world's population owns more than 95% of it. And the top 100,000 people on the planet, those who are worth more than $30 million apiece, net worth per capita, own about a third of this offshore wealth. So it's not a really democratic playground. We have a highly concentrated industry. The third thing to realize about it is that about half of the money is being managed by the world's largest financial institutions. We're talking about the same banks that were deeply involved in the world financial crisis, 2008. These are banks that I've studied since the 1980s when they were deeply involved in the third world debt crisis. They then went on to expand that activity to the first world. They all got bailed out. But over in this corner of their activity, they set up international private banking institutions, basically roam the world serving people who want to be citizens of nowhere for tax purposes. The top 1% or much less than 1% and the major corporations that are their key clients. Law firms and accounting firms are also deeply involved in this kind of practice. So I think it raises deep questions for those of us who are concerned about professional ethics and the ethics of institutions like accounting and law. At what point does this facilitation or almost money laundering become irresponsible and something to regulate? Now, I was deeply involved in the Panama Papers release back in April. It brought down, we found in the release, the largest single leak in history, about 11.2 million documents and emails, 210,000 companies. And this was just one Panama law firm with 500 employees. When we look closely at what it was up to, that tiny law firm was getting references from banks all over the world, law firms in almost every country on the planet, more than 200 countries were sending them business. So this really underscores the importance of the global haven industry in the background here, cutting across any of these individual havens. And this industry has been expanding dramatically. In 1986, I wrote a piece for the New Republic cover story about how Citibank had deployed a secret force of bankers to go to Mexico and other Latin American countries and had taken more than money out of Latin America than it had loaned to the entire continent with the help of international private bankers. And that industry has exploded since then. Going to the Philippines, I found that the Marcos Central Bank had basically borrowed money from Wall Street banks and then sent the money directly offshore to Marcos's own accounts in Switzerland. Philippines is still, to my knowledge, servicing those loans to this day. So this is an old story. And the real scandal about the Panama Papers, as we have known about this kind of behavior, the aggressive banking, the aggressive offshore haven behavior, for 40 years, and nothing has been done. There's a kind of banality of exposés. We have expose after expose, and the world community fails to take action. An advisor to the new UN Secretary General has just put this issue of tax havens right at the top of the agenda, using our figures for $32 trillion for the worldwide haven industry, and recommended that it's time to really end tax havens. I think another misnomer about tax havens is that they're just involved in tax dodging. It's actually more like the Star Wars bar scene, if you've seen that film. You see over in one corner the kleptocrats, over here you have the money launderers and the drug dealers, over there the arms dealers, the tax dodgers, and then there's a whole crop of people who are engaged in outright financial chicanery, odious finance of various kinds. So what they're sharing in common is the use of this financial secrecy that has become really easily available to the super rich and pervasive. to the point where it is undermining the strength of the nation state. So I think, you know, the notion that this is an offshore industry is also, I think, an issue that we need to re-examine, because the most important thing to know about this $32 trillion is that most of it is invested back in the first world. Nobody is really interested in investing in Panama. So the developing world in particular, when you analyze the offshore flight wealth that they've accumulated, the $12 trillion, and you add it to the $6.5 trillion of official reserves that they have, mainly invested in U.S. Treasury bills, and then you net out the $4.5 or $4.6 billion of, trillion of debt that developing countries have, they are actually net creditors to the rich world, to the tune of about $12 trillion. And that's just a pathology that I think is the biggest hidden cost of this system. It's not so much the lost taxes that we're talking about, but it's the opportunity cost of having that money invested in U.S. treasuries at, you know, less than 1% returns in real terms, rather than invested back home responsibly. So in order to get that money back to the developing world and to help stimulate development, we really have to think creatively about all the reasons that people are feeling insecure about having their investments in Nigeria or Angola, about how the banks are facilitating that offshoring and making it really cheap to hide money around the planet. We need to think carefully about how to get that money to come back. So, you know, I guess I'm very grateful for the opportunity to share this with you. I'm happy to take lots of questions, but this is a problem that I think is one that is relatively easy for us to do a lot about. It's one of those things that just requires political will and organizing. And if we just get countries if we just expose these realities, I think that we will have a chance of making some important reforms. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, James. We're now going to go into a general discussion and tease out some of these issues. I'll start off with just a brief sort of anecdote, and hopefully that will lead us into explore the mechanics of this pervasive corruption that affects so many countries. Indeed, it affects all of us, and in fact affects the quality of the civic space that we inhabit. I had the opportunity a little while ago. I spent 7 years, close to 7 years, working for and reporting closely to a European billionaire, a media magnate. And without suggesting that this person was in any way involved in anything illegal or what we've been talking about here, I was able to observe, nevertheless, that this person and those of his circle, they're flesh and blood people just like any of us. They're subject to the same mood swings, the same petty grievances, the same physical illnesses. But nevertheless, they inhabit a completely different world. They live in a parallel universe. And as much as we like to think and say that nobody is above the law, isn't it true, and I'd like each of you to talk about this in your experience of your field work, isn't it true that despite our best efforts, there are people, corporations, institutions that simply are above or beyond the law, bending the law to their own purposes as they see fit? I guess it's almost an existential question how we can expect them to abide by the laws to which the rest of us submit. Charles, would you like to start off and just talk to that in terms of your own experience?
I have noticed certain people don't get prosecuted. Honestly, look at the biggest financial meltdown in the U.S. Since the Depression, and then try to figure out how many CEOs or top executives were prosecuted personally. Mm. Instead, there were big fines that probably pay out over many years, and it was not going after these folks. I've once interviewed the head of the equivalent of the FBI in India years ago, and we got into a conversation about tax avoidance and evasion and this nice little term, tax avoidance, which the sort of gray area. And he basically admitted, and he became number two at Interpol after about a month after I interviewed him. So he was worried about this globally. He said, we can't prosecute our billionaires or get money from these guys. Mm. And he said, I'll tell you what happens. We send one of our tax people. We tell them that, you know, you didn't pay taxes last year, all this amount. And what happens is these guys get hired to work for the billionaire. And he said, we can't keep these civil servants. That's what we're dealing with. I mean, this is the depth of this problem. It cannot be overstated how significant it is. And we did a book called The Cheating of America several years ago, about 15 years ago. And we went through tax court in the U.S. and I had a team and I said, look at the 36 most outrageous examples. And then we wrote a book with 12 of those most outrageous. And then I had the fun task of trying to confront these folks. So one of them was in Belize in the jungle. And it's a long story, and it's a good story, but it'll take too long to tell. But the bottom line is I spent 25 hours talking to him over 4 or 5 days, and he admitted everything. He had been caught stealing money, taking it from where he lived, Oklahoma, over to Mexico. Federal authorities in the U.S., IRS, Internal Revenue Service, figured it out. And he was going to have to go for a grand jury. He was going to be indicted, and he had a conversation with his mother, and he said, Ma, I've got some news. I'm going to have to go away. And she goes, oh, when are you coming back? And he goes, actually, never. And he was with his third wife, and he had opened up. He was tracked all over the world. Interpol chased him all over the world. He had a yacht making fun of the IRS was the name of the boat. I forget the name, but it was a disgusting name. And he lived in a palatial estate. He had 3 or 4 chefs, one from Paris. He was having the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal shipped in daily. And he had dishes so he could see all the American football games. And I said, well, what about your family? How do you deal with that? And he goes, oh, they just come visit me occasionally. We're okay. And I said, aren't you worried that they'll come after you here? And he goes, no. I've got all the law firms in Belize City, either side politically, working for me. And if there's any change, but the extradition doesn't apply to tax evasion. It's just terrorism and maybe something else, but not tax evasion is down here somewhere. Mm-hmm. That's not probably atypical, I think. But that was just an example, but I was appalled at the arrogance and the pride, really, sheer that impunity. He had stepped away, and he thought it was funny. He was very proud.
Some of the biggest offenders here are major corporations, and they become quite skilled at parking their intellectual property, for example, patents and software and brands, in places like Ireland and Bermuda and the Cayman Islands, and paying themselves royalties tax-free. So Apple is a major brand name that you've heard of, but there are many other companies that are engaged in that same kind of dodgy behavior. And they do that because, you know, they say that it's legal in some abstract sense. Well, the fact is that they were deeply involved in structuring changes in the law since the 1980s that have facilitated all this digital offshoring in particular. The Clinton White House in 1997 did something called Check the Box, which opened the door to a lot of this behavior, heavily lobbied by the pharmaceutical industry, the software industry, which were standing to make tons of money from this. And then the people who were engaged at the Treasury doing that had a habit of going off and becoming senior vice president at Price Waterhouse or partners at major law firms. The leading IRS chief counsel for the Obama administration used to be a registered representative for the Swiss Bankers Association. Eric Holder, the attorney general, former attorney general, now back at Covington and Burling, was representing the major Swiss banks that were fined under his administration, but not jailed, for tax dodging, when he was at Covington before. So there's this problem of a revolving door culture, and there's 1,800 tax lobbyists in our capital, Washington, and they're not working for me. You know, so.
And I suspect this goes on in Angola, so I would love to hear an example, but I want to even take it further than laws that, you know, the ability of large corporations or individuals not to suffer the due process of law, where in fact the laws are weaponized against honest people. So, for example, in Tunisia, the whole tax system became a weapon of coercion against anyone the regime chose to use it against. So, for example, I decide to start to build a beautiful hotel on the Mediterranean. I don't have to pay taxes so long as I cut the ruling family into a piece of my action. So let's say it's 11%. So, fine. And then after a couple of years, the son-in-law of Ben Ali, you know, comes up to me, or his lackey comes up to me and says, 11's not enough anymore, we need 18. And I say, can't possibly do 18, it'll destroy my business. Bang, the next day I'm audited, and my business is destroyed. Is that, does that kind of thing go on, where the law is actually weaponized?
Yes. In Angola, the law is for the enemies and everything for the friends of the president. But what is interesting is the collusion with the multinationals and foreign governments to make sure that business goes as usual. And one example, for instance, is how many years ago, some years ago, the IMF found that Angola had lost $27 billion within a few years of oil revenues, and audited the accounts, found that number, and sent a team to the country. And the same IMF people that came up with the number of the money missing from the state treasury also issued a statement saying, well, there was a problem of accounting, and we will provide the technical expertise for them to do better accounting. So it's one example of, and often as James was speaking, I was just, my head was spinning with the numbers he was mentioning, and I forgot them all.
They were all very big.
Yes.
Yeah.
But that's what happened in a country like Angola.
$27 billion, people don't even understand,
They don't understand the number. But when you look at the consequences of it on the daily life of individuals, it's amazing. For instance, just days ago, as I mentioned yesterday, we have people dying of starvation in the southern southwestern part of the country because of drought. And it's an area rich in cattle. And some of the major cattle owners are also the top government officials. And they made a statement publicly saying, no, we have a solution. We will save the cattle first, because that's what means most. And then we will save
the people.
The people. So in that sense, again, it's not just the law in itself. Because when you don't have respect for the people, you know, laws don't really matter. You know, because the laws are about ensuring that sort of the regulations, the respect for the welfare of the community.
James,
I was going to say that traditional development economics looks at, and I think the national security establishment does this too, they look at the unit of analysis as the country. And in fact, all of the supporting infrastructure for kleptocracy and for tax dodging that we're talking about here couldn't exist without the tacit or even active tolerance from the international community. And so I think we have an awful lot to say if our defense establishment, for example, would say, no, we're not going to play games with corrupt dictators. We're going to crack down on that because it's not sustainable. Or if our bank regulators would take a look at some of the banking practices that they tolerate with respect to developing countries. Or if we're able to have a revised version of the international tax system, which puts developing countries in a much stronger position. These are all things the international community should do, and there's no excuse for not doing, even apart from all the indigenous corruption in country X, Y, or Z.
Charles, I'm just thinking about your man in Belize there, and I mean, is it part of the problem that I'm thinking of his boat called, was it Making Fun of the IRS? And so, part of the problem here is that for many of these people, this level of evasion is a perfectly rational and, for them, moral thing to do. They believe that taxation is theft. And And so the avoidance of it is, in a sense, an obligation. It's a demonstration of their independence, a demonstration of their cleverness. We saw a remark like that from Donald Trump a short time ago about, you know, how clever am I because I haven't paid tax. So there's that kind of, that pervading idea as well, that we're morally right not to do this.
Well, absolutely. That's the case. And the other part of it, which is related to everything else we've said, is I hate to say it, but a much more entrenched corruption in most of the advanced countries on Earth politically because of the role of money in politics. Let me give an example. In the U.S., the Congress has committees, one in each house, the Finance and Ways and Means, that deal with tax issues, and that includes oversight of the Internal Revenue Service. So in the book that we did, The Chaining of America, we looked at 30 years, and the budget for IRS had not gone up in 30 years, even though the population had gone up, the GNP, everything else had gone up. And we went and looked through the tax court records. When the IRS was bravely trying to go after some of these folks, it would be one little person, a man or woman, I don't know, in a cubicle in a big building, up against a phalanx of lawyers, 5, 10, 15 lawyers, and they would wear them down. And whenever it got resolved, it would normally be settled for 2 or 3 cents on a dollar about 10 years later. That's how, and so guess who gets audited the most? Poor folks.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with, I mean, it's that issue of the rottenness of this. It's top to bottom, and it's little things. Does Congress admit that they're corrupt about this? Of course not. Is there a discussion like this very often in the U.S.? No, et cetera. Anyway, it's frustrating. Sure.
I was going to say just financial institutions have also gotten away with murder here in the last decade. I added up the total fines and settlements and penalties paid by the top 22 banks in the world since 2000. A grand total of 680 offenses, ranging from money laundering and tax dodging to rigging LIBOR to rigging energy markets to sanctions busting, 14 different categories of offenses. And they were charged a total of $280 billion in fines. We're talking about HSBC and JP Morgan and Citibank, Credit Suisse, all of the biggest banks in the world. And yet this kind of behavior keeps going on, because during this whole period, nobody went to jail. Essentially, no CEOs went to jail. The fines were passed on to shareholders or to customers. And the way the process works is the profits from this illegal activity come before 2008. All of the fines, when they come eventually, are turning up in 2014, 2015. So even on a net present value basis, you would say this is a profitable business, taking all kinds of legal risks. So we have to figure out a new way of penalizing financial institutions that have become, in many ways, just too big to jail.
Sarah, I want to come to you and your book, Thieves of State, for a moment. First of all, a striking title and a fairly fearsome concept, really, Thieves of State. The idea of a troika there of organised criminals and private sector financial institutions, which, as some of you already mentioned, these are highly respected private sector financial institutions and government officials, all this troika sort of forming the nature of kleptocracy. But I was interested in something that you said, and you mentioned it again this morning, a structural question, and I'd like you to tease this out a little bit, that we're sometimes we think, corruption, you know, it's an illness that besets weak governments, fragile governments. But what you're saying is, but no, in fact, these are very powerful, organised criminal organisations that are masquerading as governments.
Right.
Could you tease that out a little
bit?
Yeah,
and some of the language that I'll use comes out of the study of criminal organisations, like, or of businesses. Vertical integration. When I first started thinking about this, I started to understand that these systems are vertically integrated. And by that, what I mean is the cop or the, you know, the customs agent at the bottom who, you know, if you want your goods passed through, you know, give me. That guy or gal, usually a guy, is paying part of the take up the line. In every single country that I have examined, he's paying the part of the take up the line. Very often, it's either a kickback like that or they have purchased their position. Now, what's really interesting is one of the excuses you keep hearing is that, well, the poor police officer, he's not even making enough money in his salary to be able to put food on his table for the kids. You can't really blame him. Well, my question is, let's take Afghanistan, where the United States of America was floating the entire budget of the country. Why is this guy not being paid enough? Why was the decision made not to pay salary sufficient to feed the kids? Because that bribery, you know how much it adds up to? In Afghanistan, right? Not the world's richest country. $2 to $5 billion a year. That's a gigantic revenue stream making its way upwards. So that's vertical integration. Horizontal integration is what you just mentioned, Luke, which is what I came to understand is these networks are fully interpenetrated. And Rafael was just talking over breakfast this morning about the oil blocks that belong to members of the president of Angola's family. Now, this happens all over the place. In other words, the private sector, again, particularly Americans, love to create a great distinction between private sector and public sector. And part of our election is about which is eviler, right? Is the public sector the problem or is the private sector the problem? And what we come to understand is that these are actually interpenetrated. And oh, by the way, the criminal sector is interpenetrated also. And sometimes you have individuals who play roles, you know, the same person has different hats. And so I'm looking at Honduras, a country in Latin America at the moment, in Central America. What's so fascinating is you have the drug industry, which is a gigantic industry. How they connect with the private sector is largely through the banks, because they need money laundering services. How they interact with the public sector is territorial issues. They need land, they need, you know, a blind eye turned to them as they build runways or whatever it might be. But the fact is, we are looking at an incredibly sophisticated organization and resilient one. So take countries where we've been seeing recently corruption or anti-corruption transitions. Take Tunisia, take Ukraine, take Guatemala. Interestingly, where the political structures or political parties may have fallen, the networks come back into the void. So in Tunisia, what you see is a restoration. It's a peaceful restoration, but it's a restoration of the same pre-revolution networks. Guatemala, Brazil, we've got an even more corrupt government that's taken place, the place of the Dilma Rousseff government. So that's what I'm kind of driving at.
Yeah, please, sir.
Well, I think, let me give you two examples of cases where the international community, I think, has some responsibility for this. One is the case of Zambia. You know, it's not an ordinary case of people paying bribes or corruption, but when Zambia sells its copper to the world community, it sells it basically to a company in Switzerland, and which has acquired virtual monopoly over the Zambian copper trade. But the Zambian copper, if you look at Zambia's reported exports of copper, they say it all goes to Switzerland. If you look at Swiss imports, there's no Zambian copper coming into Switzerland. Where is it going? It's going to the BVI, a haven. So if Zambia got the same price for its copper that Switzerland does, its GDP would increase by 25%. That's an example of a system that is tolerated by the world community. It's not involved with corruption, but it is involved with transferring assets. Second example I encountered in South Africa last November. And this is a case of a major Wall Street bank designing a scheme with 13 offshore companies involved, Cayman Islands, Delaware, Mauritius, that they then marketed to South African companies in order to generate essentially phony tax credits. And the Wall Street bank, still doing this today, gets paid $2 million bucks up front by the client. The scheme is implemented. It's so sophisticated, the South African Revenue Authorities had to hire specialized consultants in Boston to break it down and understand it, and then it's virtually unauditable. So that's another case of where you have, you know, 7 years after the financial crisis, major Wall Street bank engaged in unbelievably bad behavior in a developing country. And that's the kind of thing I'd like us to pay more attention to, this sort of irresponsible external community behavior.
Rafa, could I come to you? Or did you want to make a comment to that? I'm about to...
I would like just to add, for instance, there's the case now in Brazil where the former president Lula is said to be arrested. And that his case and the accusations against him involve Angola for taking bribes from construction companies. And another part of the problem is how some countries structure credit lines to developing countries. And in particular case of Angola, the Brazilian Bank of Development would provide loans to Brazilian construction companies for work in Angola, and then kickbacks would be taken from that money for the political parties and for the political elite in Brazil. So it meant that most of the money never actually went to Angola, stayed in Brazil. Just the debt was to be paid by Angola in oil. And we have also another case in Portugal of the former prime minister who spent a year in jail and has been indicted as well, involves Angola as well for kickbacks taken from Angola, the same schemes. And then we have other cases. In 2004, there was a major case of corruption involving French officials for selling weapons to Angola illegally through an arms trade dealer. And what happened was that the arrangement, and there was tax avoidance there, there are all sorts of problems. And how did it get resolved? The French authorities, because they were interested in the Angolan oil, came to an arrangement with the Angolan government, and they appointed the main arms trade dealer, who was at the epicenter of the case, as the second in charge of the Angolan embassy to UNESCO, to give him immunity. And with that immunity, then the French government said, well, we cannot keep him in jail because he has immunity. And Angola paid $50 million for the case to be dropped. And what happens, and often is not talked about, the prosecutor for the case, a woman named Eva Julie, who also has a Norwegian citizenship, she got into so much trouble that she basically had to leave France and go and live in Norway. It's just to give an example of how often we ignore the fact that there is persecution, sometimes for those trying to break that sort of connection between Western governments, companies in the developed world, in the way they do business with developing countries and help local dictators to remain in power and do all sorts of shady deals. And one final example, it has to do with the oil sector as well in Angola. There is a company that I exposed, a US company, Cobalt, for having a partnership with two Angolan generals and the current vice president. And a criminal investigation was lodged against them in the US. But then the company was left off the hook by ECC, even though the evidence is there. But there is, I think, a case being pursued by the Justice Department. Chevron, BP, Statoil, all the multinationals have the same kind of arrangements with top officials in the country, who are also the main business people in the country. But no one is going after them.
So what this actually brings up, what these both of these, I think, anecdotes bring up, is we're used to the expression transnational organized crime, right? That's a common expression. We are talking transnational corruption networks. And yet, for example, in the United States, we have sanctions regimes, meaning you can apply individualized sanctions against transnational organized criminals. That's easy. That's politically easy. But it's politically very awkward to think about these networks of government corruption as transnational criminal networks. The second thing I'd like to say is I've started trying to map out what this actually looks like, what these criminal organizations look like. There's something called a network analysis, which I used to see very often when I was in Afghanistan. I would go into a little, you know, brigade or battalion tactical operations center, and I'd have a young 20-something-year-old intelligence officer who would very proudly show me the network diagram for a little Taliban, you know, a little Taliban group of sort of 10 or 20, and I'd say, well, show me the one for the district chief, and I wouldn't get one, because they hadn't even looked at it. So I've been trying at least to depict institutionally what some of these corruption or these horizontally and vertically integrated criminal organizations look like for a couple of countries. And then I go, for example, tomorrow I'm going to Canberra to talk to your foreign ministry. And one of the things I'm going to suggest is you guys need to do some of this intelligence analysis. Now, I don't know what their answer is going to be, but many other countries, including my own, the answer I get is, oh, that's really sensitive. That actually informing themselves about the shape of these networks is too sensitive, whereas pouring billions of dollars into a country like this, or partnering with either private sector or public sector, partnering with elements of this kind of network is not sensitive. I mean, how is that possible?
Mr. James, and then I'm going to come to you,
Rafael. Yeah,
I mean, I think it underscores the importance of investigative journalists, of the independent NGOs, of the activists who, you know, the Panama Papers and a lot of other investigations were not done by government. They weren't done by law enforcement. They were basically, you know, hardworking people. And a lot of the work that ought to be done by... you know, perhaps by government in its own interests, is left to whistleblowers, you know, people who are very courageous and are, you know, have suffered greatly. During the Obama administration, we've had more prosecutions of whistleblowers than ever before, really. So, I mean, there is a whole host of issues that are raised by this conversation, but I think one of them is that investigative economics, investigative journalism really needs to be a priority, and we have to think about ways to protect the people who are engaged in it and who are their sources, because that's producing most of the evidence that we're talking about here today.
I've got to go. Rafa, I want to ask you about your work with Maka Angola, but Charles, would you like to just have another comment about what we've been discussing?
The investigative journalism part, or which part?
Any part
if you like. Yes, yes.
It's
jump back in,
you know,
and then I'm going to come to Rafa.
Equal opportunity panel.
So, a couple things. Obviously, I agree with James about the investigative reporting part, and I started the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists in 1997, and I think this Panama Papers project was the 26th cross-border collaboration involving 400 reporters, 75 countries, 100 news organizations, and as you noted, 11.2 million records. That could only be possible because they had done three or four other tax evasion secrecy projects that led up to it. So they developed a learning curve on how to do it. But that brings me to a larger point. I mean, we could talk about collaboration, which is related to this. I think this has to include academics. We just did a project with a public anthropologist tracking every U.S. military base and installation on planet Earth. No journalist has ever done that. I don't know why, but they haven't. And so they're brilliant. There's 6,500 non-government organizations in the world of varying quality, but many of them have former journalists working there, but also a lot of brilliant people and a lot of great research offices. And 19 Human Rights Watch is an example. 19 offices, every continent in the world. So we're getting this knowledge community that actually does care about the world. But that's not good enough. It's great. It's exciting. I love it. But I mentioned this yesterday, but I still think it We have this gap between nation states and how they function or not. And we don't have a multilateral international structure. It hasn't been developed, and there's a lot of disincentives that we've been hearing here up here to develop it, for any of the kleptocracies, for example, to cede their authority or their jurisdiction or anything to any other body. So we're in this weird place in the 21st century where we actually, it's pretty obvious what the problem is, and it transcends nation states, yeah. And it's offshore, which is ungovernable, 60 to 90 offshore jurisdictions, where every bad thing on planet Earth mostly occurs, from pornography to cybersecurity issues to gun running to you name it, in addition to the stuff we're discussing. Yeah. No one is governing any of it, and journalists don't know how to cover it very easily, frankly. A nice big leak helps, but it's not like you have a lot of journalists in those 60 to 90 jurisdictions, and so this is a big problem that we have a huge amount of work to do. It's no question.
Rafa, talking about, corruption as a system of government, and I'd like you to talk a little bit about your work with Maka Angola, because your point, of course, is not just that about corruption as a system of government, but that phenomenon is intimately linked then to torture and human rights abuses, which you have documented. But also, can I just mention for people who don't know that Rafa is also very much the embodiment, literally, of that fight against corruption. He has suffered imprisonment, beatings, harassment, and suffered conditions that most of us would just find absolutely intolerable. So, Rafa, can I ask you, first of all, how have you survived thus far? And secondly, tell us a little bit about the work that you're doing with Maka Angola.
Let me first just to recap an experience, a family experience. During the communist period of Angola, my mother was arrested for having 2 kilos of sugar as a saboteur of the economy and took to trial. And for years I thought about that. I said, you know, how can the very same people who arrested my mother for having 2 kilos of sugar, now they're billionaires and they have taken it from the state, and they're not sabotaging the economy. They're not depriving people of their goods. Because we had a system in those days of ration cards, and the average family had the right to 2 kilos of sugar per month from the people's shop. And there was a special shop, of course, for the leaders, with the whisk, cheese and everything. So the question is how we allow these individuals to change the discourse according to the circumstances and keep punishing people while they adapt to the new realities that the world somehow, or they feel, impose on them. And when I started investigating corruption, and my mother gave an example on this case, she slept in court because she refused to go to jail. She had a child with her, and then they said, oh, you must send the child home with someone. She said, no, it's my child, I'll sleep here, and you try me here, or you send me to jail with my child. And they said, we don't have conditions in jail for the child. Then she said, I will stay here. And then she slept in court. And then the following day, the judge said, you're too much of a trouble, go home. and that's basically how she got out of it. And when I started investigating corruption, it was by accident. Once I was asked by a police commander, I worked for the state newspaper, to investigate how one senior member of the regime, close to the president, and was running a terminal in the main harbor, was basically opening all the containers, taking the goods, and stocking up his own shops, and then giving the empty containers to the clients. And so I went there and I investigated with the police. And wrote the story for the state newspaper, which is to this date This was back in 92, and it's still the only daily newspaper in the country. I wrote the story, and then the very same member of parliament, businessman, president's friend, sent his brother to the newsroom to threaten us, to deny the story, and his brother was a general. But then we put a fight against the general, so he went and struck a deal with the director of the newspaper, and the director wrote the denial that it was not true. And then I thought, how do we tell the truth if we don't have the means to do it in a sense of having the space? And that's when I started this project many years later, when I felt I had no other option to work, was basically out of not having options of work. So I started MacAngola as a website to investigate corruption, because I was actually doing a master's degree at Oxford, and I decided to focus on corruption. And one day I went to a state institution just to look for some documents, and I just realized there was all this information on corruption and the companies that government officials had set up, and it was all there. Mm. And then I started going there disguised as an individual who was going a bit crazy, because I thought, aren't they noticing what's going on here, that I have access to all these documents? And I just kept taking pictures of them and taking pictures of the staff and taking the pictures back to them. Because I said, there must be a trap here for them to allow me to see all these documents. There wasn't. So I collected the documents that I still use today. And this was 6-7 years ago. But when I started publishing these articles, I realized the level of resistance from the authorities was quite staggering. And I'll give you an example. The current Minister of Territorial Administration, I exposed his business dealings, and he was CEO of several companies as well, chairman of the board of banks and so forth. And then when I exposed all that, he wrote an open letter published in a newspaper saying that I would die poor, my family would suffer, and he would be very generous to offer 5% of his shares in one of the companies if I accepted publicly in writing, because that was my last chance to provide for my family. And so when that pressure is put on an individual to consider whether you're for taking a stand on honesty, integrity, you are actually undermining the very survival of your family. Mm-hmm. It resonates across many countries. And I said, well, I don't care. Of course, I didn't even bother to reply to that letter. But the reactions, and just today I finished writing about the Attorney General of Angola, mm-hmm. who bought a piece of land from the state as a rural land and paid peanuts to build a luxury housing project by the beach. And that is illegal and unconstitutional, even in a country that is so corrupt as Angola. And but 15 days ago, I sent him a letter with 13 questions, the last one of which was, why don't you resign to have some dignity? So, but what I have been doing as well with these cases, I said, well, if they are going to prosecute me for telling the truth, let me at least have the opportunity to use the very same judicial system to lodge complaints against them. Because before they come after me, they have to hear my cases. And so, and that's where, for instance, the Attorney General's office has been reversing the cases I lodge against me. But finally, after having tried so many times last June, finally a general was indicted for land grabbing. This general took over 300 square kilometers of arable land for himself in the province he's ruling. You know, it's a huge extension. So, but the problem again is the generosity afforded to these individuals by the international community.
Mm. Yeah.
that deals with them. And for instance, Angolan officials have been able to buy up huge stakes in banks in Portugal to be the entry point to Europe and to the West. Telecom companies, even the Portuguese media, now is partly owned by Angolans, just to avoid information on Angola to be printed in Portugal. Mm.
Yeah. Did you have a comment there,
I have no story to compare to Rafael's courage, but I do have occasionally there are breakthroughs in investigative journalism where you have something good happen. I was once sued by the president of the Brazilian Supreme Court for libel. We'd published this piece in Jornal do Brasil, which was an exposure of this American drug dealer. Anyway, he had bribed the president of the Brazilian Supreme Court. And for 3 years, I couldn't travel to Brazil. But I was able to go to the final court session where we produced the guy who had actually carried the bribe to the judge. And he said, and we were all sitting there rapt, listening to his testimony, and he said, you know, the journalists got it wrong. The bribe was not $200,000. It was $400,000. And that was the end of that case. But at the end of the day,
just one thing that occurs to me from, again, these stories. Investigative journalism is great, thank God, you know, for these three guys and everything they represent. I'm sometimes left a bit uncomfortable when I hear government officials saying how important investigative journalism is, and as though it's a sort of panacea for the problems that we're talking about. Yeah. These guys are unbelievably vulnerable. I mean, that this guy is sitting in front of you is a kind of miracle. Yeah. So often what you have is sort of self-righteous governments that talk about how important civil society is and investigative journalists, and maybe give a little bit of, you know, a couple hundred thousand dollars to, you know, this organization or that organization, while $1 billion in military assistance goes to the very government against which the investigative journalist is writing or researching. And truth and exposure is critical, but it's sort of like a hammer. Hammer's great, except if there's no anvil, right? If the hammer's just swinging through the air, it's not gonna produce really any result. And so you have the stories of the legal options, but you really require, you know, transparency and exposure is only valuable within a system of legal recourse. But where you don't have legal recourse, exposure in and of itself is not going to be a solution to the problem.
We're going to go. I've noticed some questions have been coming in, and we're going to go to questions in a moment in the audience and via Twitter. But I just wanted to one last question for you, Sarah. Is it the case that sometimes we avoid the harder questions or the deeper analysis by making very easy cultural assumptions about, oh yes, well, corruption, well, of course, you know, that's the Italians, that's the Saudis, that's the Afghans, they're like that. So we make these assumptions that these cultures are per se corrupt in and of themselves, whereas
absolutely.
That's absolutely not the case.
I mean, I heard that all the time, and all I can say very simply is, I have never heard that argument made by an Afghan, by an Angolan, by a Nigerian, by an Uzbek, by a Tunisian. I've never had any person from any of those countries come up to me and say, Sarah, would you stop with your corruption obsession? It's just part of our culture. We don't mind it, right? That is not an objection I've ever gotten. I've gotten that argument exclusively from Westerners. But let's go. I'd love to hear what some of the questions are.
Well, here's one straight up. Do you think, and whoever would like to answer this, do you think corruption plays a role in the privatisation of healthcare services? Who'd like
to
start?
So two quick examples. One is ours in the United States, where if you were to look at the parties of men who are favoured, who have bent the laws to their advantage. One is military, one is oil, one is Wall Street, one is certainly health. Second, just look at Honduras, where there was a gigantic scandal where the government, I mean, essentially sawdust was being made into pills for the public health service.
Just the U.S. real quick, we have five times more private contractors as employees doing government work as we actually have government officials in the old context of working in the government. Mm-hmm. Freedom of Information Act doesn't really apply to them. The conflict of interest laws are not the same as being inside the government. One time the Secretary of the Army went to find out how many people worked in the Army Department, and he had to hire a company to tell him what the number was. I mean, so, and of course, the amounts of money, the salaries for the private folks are sometimes double what the civil servants get, which of course denigrates public service itself, but it also enriches these folks. And that's in the U.S., but this is a common issue everywhere, and it's a really serious problem. It's basically giving carte blanche to folks to do whatever the hell they want, and it's still happening.
Here's another one, and then we'll go direct to the audience. What will the Trans-Pacific Partnership mean for corruption? Because that's a fairly broad question. James, do you have a take on that?
Well, it's interesting. One of the provisions of the TPP that people are concerned about is the impact on sweatshops, because we have Vietnam basically being admitted, if the TPP were passed, into the family, and they don't allow trade unions. So it isn't so much a question of corruption, although Vietnam is laden with corruption, but it's just the sheer inability to organize and to have labor rights and restrictions on hours and wages. And so that's, I think, opening a door that we really shouldn't be opening.
Would anyone in the audience like to ask a question? Yes, sir, I know you had your hand up there before. We do have some roving mics, so if we could just get a microphone to you, and we'll go to you first, and then there was a question over there, number two, and we'll should have time for probably three or four questions. Oh, there, number three as well. Yep. Okay.
Did you get the one on the
edge? I did, over there. Okay, it's number two and number three. So we've got our first three questions at least lined up, yes.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think we've had some very good stories of, about the issues that have been raised globally. It seems to me the remark that Sarah made right at the start, it's all about money and the movement of money. And all the money around the world is moved by the big international banks. Mm. And these are the banks we label too big to fail and too big to prosecute. Unless we can control the movement of money through the banking system, this topic of issues will pervade the world. Corruption in all the countries, and several have been mentioned, will not be solved unless we stop the movement of money that is illegal. And the only way we can control that is by controlling the big banks and prosecuting the people that have offended in these systems. We need to bring them to account. It's no good to saying they're too big to prosecute or too big to fail. That's not the answer. The answer is control the movement of money, and I think we'll solve the problems. That's my view.
Thank you. Thank you. That's a comment there. Did anyone want to just make a tack?
Just real quick in a sentence.
Yep.
At least in the U.S., but I think in many other countries, laws about banks are promulgated in the legislation that is passed, and the chairs of those committees get massive sums of money from the banks. People serve on those committees for the simple reason it's the most lucrative committee in terms of campaign finance money. And any democracy that has some legislative oversight over these processes becomes beholden to those banks. I'm not saying it shouldn't be done or can't be done. At the moment, it's not being done, partly because there are no checks and balances, because the way we do it is all by committees on certain subjects, which, of course, then become beholden to. It's basically a sort of an incestuous situation where they're all helping each other.
I'd like to take it, I agree with you, and I agree with, as you can, we're all in quite violent agreement about this. but I would also like to just bring it back again to a deeper layer, which is it's not just about the physical movement of money. It's also about how much our societies value money and make the ownership and display of money one of the principal factors of social approval and social stature. So I remember, again, Nigerian friends saying, we are celebrating the bandits and the looters on television because, you know, their wedded, their extravagant weddings and their private jets are being, you know, basically exalted on television. And this is something all of us need to really think through. Look at and look at who is rewarded or what other types of social, of human values, integrity, wisdom, education, creativity. How much are our societies valuing those compared to how much they're valuing the individuals who have amassed money? And where is the hypocrisy and the gap between what we say we value and what we actually value as people?
Rafa, then James, and then we do got the other question.
Just following up on Sarah, there's a Nigerian friend who said, we make corruption look cool, and our job is to make it uncool. So basically how you debunk it and make sure people understand that there will be no rewards for having the flashy cars with stolen money and the appearances that come with it.
Did you have a quick question?
I was going to say that I've been working a fair amount with Haiti on the problem of remittances. I took a whole course to from Colombia down there to work on this issue. Haiti is a country, like many others, that's increasingly dependent on private transfers from some of the poorest people on the planet who are working abroad. Haiti's case, it's now about 25% of GDP coming from 2.2 million Haitians living in the United States who are sending money back to their relatives in Haiti. And worldwide, it's $600 billion. It's about four times as much as all development assistance. So it's essentially private sector aid. The problem when it comes to the banking system is that there is an international remittance cartel operated by players like Western Union with their local partners. And they're charging these poorest people on the planet 10 to 15 cents for every $100 that they're sending back, when the real cost of the transfers is more like 1 to 2%. So there's a concrete example of where the banking problem is not only one of kind of too big to fail, but it's something where, you know, this industry has gotten control over a market. And we really should think about, again, an example of something that's not within any particular country. It's a problem of a system that's reinforcing this extraction.
Thank you, James. Yes, sir, over there on the left.
Yes, it's been a tremendous panel. Thank you all very much. My question relates to the fact that we've heard the problem documented very well today, and we've got investigative journalists and fantastic advocates. I'm trying to sort of grapple with where is the key point or driver for change? And no one's mentioned people power. Mm-hmm. I mean, in this country, back in the 70s, we were able to achieve fantastic things in terms of overcoming the Vietnam War and conscription and environmental causes. These days, we don't tend to have people that will get out on the street. We can get 50,000 to go for a walk for breast cancer. Why can't we get 100,000 to go for a walk for, you know, sort of not only anti-corruption, but the bank behaviour and things like that? We've got a government here that's about to spend $50 billion on tax relief. I'd like to know how many of the companies pay the current tax level. So I'd like to ask the panel whether you think there's any hope for people power in this sort of thing. And I guess your comment earlier, Sarah, about the Trump and the Hillary thing, the 70% against, that seems to be encouraging for me on one level, but how do we take that level of concern and then mobilise it to help the cause?
I think that's an absolutely great question. I think that's a fantastic question, and we had actually discussed it a little bit ahead of time, that, you know, there's some degree of people power against, for example, sweatshops, although it hasn't gone as far as it could go. But why? I mean, I've enjoyed the sort of humor of this panel also, but it disturbs me a little bit too, and I've participated, obviously, but we've been laughing at the examples of the super corrupt that we've been hearing. And so long as we laugh at it without getting into the street against it, that's a little bit dangerous, because again, we can sort of laugh it off. And so the real, I think that's an absolutely fantastic question. And again, some of the younger people in the room, I'd love you to go back to your institutions and think about campaigns, because the universities, in terms of people power, are often great catalyzers, or even high schools. Go back to your institutions and think about what are some of the colluders here in Australia with the situations that we've been describing that you can get out and shame, and you can get out and demonstrate in front of their corporate headquarters. I mean, right now in America, we're having all of the universities are up in arms about, you know, should we call Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of International, whatever it is, Woodrow Wilson School, when he, in fact, was racist? Or, you know, I mean, they're like, literally, they're trying to change the seal of their institution that was, you know, created in the 18th century, which I understand the symbolic value of it, but oh my God, getting together around a campaign like that would be so much more influential in terms of today's realities. So take this as a rallying cry for how could we organize some really creative campaigns.
Okay. One, two, and then you, ma'am, and then we're going to run out of time, so you just...
I think one of the major issues, especially in Africa, has to do with the way in which government officials have been able to sell petty corruption as a way of life
right.
to people. So that the police officer believes that his only way to feed his family is by taking bribes. The teacher, the health workers, just to give you an example, I wrote just 2 months ago about health workers in the diamond areas of Angola that have been without pay for the past 8 months. And my question to them was, why are you working? Why don't you protest? And their response staggered me. They said, well, if we don't do it, people will die. The government will not care. And we're too far away from the news for anyone to pay attention. Mm. So I think it's very important. And the reason why in my work, for instance, as a journalist, I go out of the way to file criminal complaints, to raise all sorts of issues, it's to try to shed light to some of these issues so that people start understanding that they should not worry about the petty corruption. They should worry about the grand corruption and not compare and say, well, we're taking our part and the officials who have better places have the right to take more. So it's kind of a division of labor here yes. that government officials try to impose on people to say, we, the officials, have to take more and you at the bottom have to take less. And so to change the mentality is the most difficult part of the job. But definitely, that's what also must be the most rewarding.
James, just briefly, and then we'll have to take your question, maybe even as a comment, but we will get to you. Yes, James.
Well, I really agree with the point of having mass organization around these issues, because too often NGOs get trapped into lobbying and technical issues. And the key to mass organization is to have very specific, concrete proposals
yeah.
that you can organize around. Let me give you an example. At Yale University, they sell Yale sweatshirts for $38. And we've had students look at the value chain, just do a project on that. How much does the university get per sweatshirt? $2.50. How much do the workers in Mexico who make the sweatshirt get? 17 cents. So there was an immediate issue about, you know, shouldn't we be having the university rebate part of the $2.50 they get for the label, Yale, to the workers that are making the sweatshirt? Starbucks, coffee. Everybody loves Starbucks. They go and spend $5 on a cup of coffee. Do you know how much of that actually gets to the coffee farmers? It's less than a cent, even with fair traded coffee. And lately we've found Starbucks paying bribes in Guatemala to the coffee trade buyers and then depositing it in Switzerland. And, you know, this is an example of, you know, so what is the demand there? Let's have Starbucks make it easy for us at the purchase point to send an extra 20 cents per cup to the farmer, to the cooperatives in Guatemala, or wherever that is that the coffee is being grown. That's a very concrete demand. I proposed a tax on anonymous wealth, because we have an awful lot of anonymous owners of foreign wealth coming into your country and to ours. And that's an example of a concrete proposal. So there's a lot of specific things we can organize around, but that's the way forward.